First of all, I apologize that I have to keep my cell phone on. So please, if it rings, I always believe that there are two ways. Some people say keep your cell phone off and do this and that. This is one approach to life. The other one is practice concentration even on the battlefield. So it doesn't matter whether cell phones are ringing or not ringing. It's a beautiful opportunity given to us at every moment, whether our inner cell phone is attuned and correctly aligned or not. Life is a paradox. We all know that. The answer precedes the question. Even today, we witnessed it when Deepshikadi ended up such a beautiful invocation by invoking the Divine Mother and surrendering to her. Sharanam, Sharanam, Sharanam. I don't think that there can be any better or more final answer to whether the enigma of health or the enigma of existence, of creation. All our understanding eventually leads us to that point where we discover the utter, in all humility and truth, the utter helplessness of who we are and what we are. The beauty is, the good news is, that the path to light opens from that. We are like a newborn baby. As long as we believe we can do things, very often it happens that, I'm not speaking here, I can see a very polished and refined people who I'm sure know more than me. So there is nothing really to share. But I have seen that, you know, when we speak to people, they believe, oh, there is a camp on health, I'll have a issue sorted out. You know, I'll have my diabetes cured, I'll have my blood pressures coming down. I wish there was something like that, you know, a magic wand. There is none. And the beauty is that this acknowledgement opens the door to all possibility. It is from here that omnipotence starts. So beautifully when we see in Agenda Mother describing the final moment of transition takes place when she speaks of the helplessness like a baby. As long as our mind believes that we can do something, that I have a system, oh, homeopathy can cure it, all illnesses. Allopaths are not the only arrogant fellows. They are, I know, and very arrogant. But all pathies become arrogant. Oh, this, I'll do this healing and it'll be out. It's a kind of arrogance where we believe that we know everything and we can do everything. The fact is that we don't, and yet it is given to man to open to something that is all-knowing and all-powerful. And I think that's where the beauty of surrender lies, the joy of surrender, the possibility of surrender. But there is much that goes on between where we stand today and where we have to reach. Where we stand today is a state of disintegration, a ground of disintegration. And disintegration is the door to death. With every breath of life, we open also with every breath a door to death. This is the paradox. And the reason is that the very consciousness in which we live is a state of disintegration. That's why the moment a child is born, the process starts. What is it that we are disintegrated with? It doesn't need much philosophy. In fact, philosophy is best left aside. But very, very practically, if we take a look at ourselves, at any given point of time, our consciousness moves in a very, very narrow fringe. We are conscious of that moment. We are conscious of a small little element in the totality of the cosmos. We are conscious maybe of a little thought which is going on in our head like a fly. You know what happens when sometimes people sit for meditation near the samadhi because of the flower. We are not the only people attracted. Also there are flies. Many beings. And the fly suddenly takes a liking to us. And off goes meditation and in comes the fly. So we are conscious of a small little spectrum, not even a spectrum, maybe a thought at the moment, and we are not aware that it's a small little world in which we are trapped. And in that world we dream all kinds of things. And we think it to be real. All kinds of things we build there. What's going to happen? What's going to happen? This is our state. At that point of time, we are not aware of the millions and millions of processes, millions and millions of forces that are all the time acting, impinging upon us without our knowledge. This is the state of disintegration. Our feelings acknowledge a very, very small range. They move again in as normally me and my loved ones. That's it. Loved ones, those who serve my interests, makes it even more simpler. State of disintegration. Everything else is disconnected. It's not me. Why should I bother what's happening in Iraq? I'm not the one who is suffering. It doesn't matter at all. So there is a disintegration within us between different parts of our being. If we see our life just from morning to night, and for some reason, if the element of memory goes away, we won't even know whether it's the same person from morning till night or it's a different person throughout. Morning we wake up with such lovely thoughts. Most people wake up with nice thoughts. They make an offering to the divine, at least in certain context. Wonderful, nice aspiration, nice bath, good perfume. But as we go out into the world, we are sullied both physically and psychologically. It's not just the pollutants that the truck throw, and there's a lot of hue and cry about those pollutants. But the pollutants of hate, anger, jealousies, ill will, all kinds of things coming from all around. Innocuous statement. Just this morning I was sharing it with somebody. You know, there's a very dangerous tendency among human beings. You know, ego takes many forms, and this form is very strange. And this is called, Mother has used the word gossip. What is gossip? Oh, you know, this fellow. You know what? I'm not sure. I saw him, and then it goes. Just nothing, innocuous statement. The person has gone. But left something within you, deposited. Like flies deposit their eggs, which will hatch out. Like mosquitoes bite and leave in the bloodstream a small little larva. Mosquito has gone or you have killed. You think, I have succeeded, I have killed the mosquito. But it has left inside, deposited a maggot, a larva which will change into malaria over a period of time. So the same thing happens with us all through as we navigate through life. It's full of that. The mother at one place said, my child, the atmosphere of this world is full of filth. She has used the word filth, which we don't see. We generate it. It's not that somebody else. See, human nature, that's how it is shot through and through with the ego. And there is a vicious interest that people take. So when we talk about prevention, let's start from here. Small little thing. Let's take a resolve that we are not going to speak ill of anyone. Or even think about it. And we have to check ourselves when we are talking to people that look, you know, X. We should immediately hold our tongues that no, this is not what is going to help in health, promoting health. Before I can think about how I will be healthy, let's try to live a life which is full of health. Now, normally we will not connect even this with health. There are people who do exercises, do all the right things physically. They have a very routine life. I have seen such people, I am sure everybody has seen. From morning till evening, they do exercise, they eat the right amount of food, right kind of food. They are vegetarians, they don't drink, they don't smoke. Everything they do, right. And they fall ill. So one wonders what's missing. This is missing. It's a state of disintegration by its very nature. All the time, we are as if at war with everyone else. This need to affirm and survive has taken such a strange thing in human nature. Added to that is something which the mind brings in. In animal creation, there is an integration with nature, with the totality, spontaneous, instinctive. Animals breathe it. It's like they know the seasons. They have not read books. You know, we write books on animal behavior and National Geographic observes so much. And you know, there'll be such lovely documentaries. Animal behavior. And we are amazed. The beauty is animal doesn't learn it from a book. how to behave, what to do, but it makes spontaneously the movements necessary. In connection, it's always in connect with nature, and nature gives it all that is necessary for it to remain, maintain its health and progression through the number of years that it is meant to live. It's so beautiful when one, you know, Shobhinda has a very beautiful aphorism to it. The difference between, one place he says, difference between God and man. And he says, God plays the fool in season. Man plays the fool in season and out of season. And equally he speaks about the animal life and the human life in similar terms. That animals do things, they do it in season. It's okay. They will not, you know, do beyond that. They are given a certain things by nature and they follow that. But human beings, because of the mind, it's a very strange, aspect which has come up. I'm sure Falguni will talk about it in Planes and Parts of Being. It's something very strange. It's, one wonders whether it's really an evolution or a retrogression. Because of the mind, we have entered into an evolutionary loop where it cuts us off from that kind of integration which we had with nature. We have lost it. And the mother speaks about it at great length, and the Bible has spoken about it as the great fall. This is the fall spoken of in the Bible, that man tasted the fruit of knowledge. But now that we have entered it, we have no choice. We have to complete the full cycle. We can't go back to nature and become an animal. It's not given to us. And the reason why we have entered it, because it's a transition, a narrow passage. Navigating through it, we have to reach at another zone, another land, where we will reintegrate, but consciously and in a different way. This is the journey. So the second problem is that we believe that man's mind can know everything, solve everything, and it takes sometimes one lifetime, to say the least, many lifetimes to discover this one simple truth. See, the greatest truths are very simple. This is one great truth, very simple, takes so long to discover, that the human mind is really, really, for all its knowledge, ultimately, we do not know even the step in front. People say this, oh, we'll see you tomorrow. A nice little story in Mahabharata, when you know there was a bell in those days, and any citizen who felt aggrieved could ring the bell and the emperor will step out and solve the issue then. Yes, he can't, like, it's not like dates in the court and going on. He had to come out. He was answerable. So one day somebody rings the bell at an odd hour seeking justice, and he sent a message. Yudhishthir, such a, you know, wise king, yet says, okay, tomorrow we will sort it out. So this man says it's urgent, and he goes and tells Bhima. Now Bhima is a very straightforward man. There's the beauty of this character, much undernoticed, but he is really a hero. This man has no qualms, but he acts on a straightforward impulse. So he goes and rings the bell number of times, and all the people come, what's happened? Bhima is seeking justice. He says, no, I am not seeking justice. I want to make a declaration. What is the declaration? The emperor has become immortal. What? The news reaches Yudhishthira and says, you know, Bhima has declared that you have become immortal. He says, this fellow plays pranks. Sure enough, he comes and says, Bhima, what is this? He says, surely you must be immortal because you said I'll solve the problem tomorrow. So you are sure that you are going to be alive tomorrow. And only a person who is immortal can say this, that I am going to be alive tomorrow. See, with all our knowledge, man does not know even the step in front. He waits to weigh the certitude of his thoughts. He knows not whether at last he shall survive or perish from the earth like the mastodon and the sloth. This is the degree of abysmal ignorance in which we live. So mind is, what Shobhinda said, it's a transitional consciousness. It's something which is given to us to navigate further. If we stay stuck there and want answer to things, all our answers, I'm afraid, will be temporary. This pathy, that pathy, any pathy, we may try. It will be temporary. So the solution is to go beyond it. The integration that animal has with nature, this is another kind of, one is integrating within, Within integration is also very difficult because we don't know the center. Morning to night, we have contradictory wills. Even people don't know what they really want in life. Today they want one thing, tomorrow they want another thing. If God comes, they will not know what to ask. There was this man who was feeling very hungry and God gave him 3 boons. He said, first give me a hot samosa. And then he added quickly for me and my wife. So he says, okay, what about the other 2 boons? He says, okay, let me ask my wife and come. So he goes, says, you know, this is the first boon I have asked, samosas, nice hot samosa. He says, what nonsense, you are an idiot, God is here and you have asked for samosas. So the man gets very cheesed off. He says, this hot samosa may stick to you, your nose. And so it sticks to her nose. And he says, oh my God, I wasted the second boon. And the third boon is only that, let it come out of the nose, because what God has stuck can't come out.
And this is how, from morning till night, from night till morning, we live with contradictory elements in our being. And this is one source of the perpetual disintegrative process. There is, you know, very often people talk about going through school curriculum, and they speak about modifying the curriculum in education, and you know, it should be taught this way, it should be taught that way. There's a lot of debate going on all over the world, I'm sure. But you know what is not taught? The most important element which is missing is how to strengthen your will. Without the will, one may have all the knowledge in the world and you can do nothing, absolutely nothing about it. In the Vedas, there is so much of song and obeisance paid to the will. In fact, the Rig Veda is full of, you know, of course, the divine will, but in human being, there is a reflection of it. So we talk about, you know, even the most serious attack of illness, when there are no other resources, we don't believe in God. There are people who don't believe in God, it's okay. They don't have faith. But if they have this element of will, strong, one-pointed, centered, best if it is aligned, but even if it's not there, it is a great power. But we have never exercised this power. We drift on the sands of time. Desires lead us here, there, all kinds of things. And at the end of the day, we say, oh my God, I can't get rid of this. So there is an inner something around which we can reorganize our life. But for that, we must be clear about what is the central point. And that's where one big discovery awaits us. And the mother has made it so beautifully clear. As long as we live in the ego and by the ego, the integration will always be a makeshift arrangement. Typical example is the democratic parliament house. It's always a makeshift arrangement. It cannot, you know, the speaker is the most helpless fellow. And if it tries to exercise its power, as recently the speaker did, I expel the members. It creates greater ruckus and greater chaos. So this is how our will is. But yet, if our will can be rightly oriented and reorganized, it's a tremendous element to integrate the different parts. At least that is the bare minimum, first level of integration. Whether we want one thing, another thing, let's try to find the central theme of our life, central plot, and then we will see that health and everything else will fall into place. And that is the central thread of our life.
Very often, we lose the big plan while chasing short plans. We enter the by lanes. It's like, you know, some people coming to Pondicherry, and on the way, somebody tells them, you know what, Hyderabad is a very nice city and there are nice pearls sold here. And there is also Salar Jung Museum. So I get down and I start enjoying Hyderabad and Salar Jung Museum. And somebody says, you know, Hyderabad has very fine cuisines. Oh, let me try it. And then third person says, why don't you marry a Hyderabadi girl? Because, you know, she can make very good food. So you get married, you settle down, take a job, and you've forgotten all about your goal. Well, if that's how we lead our life, sure enough, there will be all kinds of misery. So there is the inner plot. There is a will that is deeper, which is leading us. Shubhendu says very beautifully that God is leading man while man is misleading himself. And when we don't align ourselves to it, then life becomes a chaos. All our outer circumstances are simply a reflection of our inner state. An inner confusion will lead to an outer confusion. But we have always a choice of reorienting, recorrecting. So take an example now, practically what does it mean? When there are challenges outside, whether they come in the form of illness or they come in the form of outer difficulties or circumstances which seem impossible, or various forms of pathologies in our own life, dysfunction socially, etc. Then what is the solution? We try to find an external solution. But the real solution is reorienting our will. If we reorient our will and take the route meant for us, things will fall in place. This is something which I have seen, and I am sure many persons have seen it. It's so very true. If we just reorient it, reconnect ourselves to the inner theme, when we follow that, there is a beautiful word in the Gita, Swadharma and Swabhav. If we follow that inner thread, then things will fall into their right place. That right place need not be my place, the way I want them, but it will fall in its place. It will stop troubling. It will create a growing sense of another harmony at another level, a new kind of harmony. Life is meant for that. But if we don't follow it, we try to impose our small will upon the cosmos, then we are baffled, we are frustrated, we feel, oh, this world has been created by somebody who is very bad guy, who doesn't take us into confidence, doesn't consult us. Well, that's a fact that God doesn't consult us, and perhaps it's better that He doesn't consult us, because if He consults us, we'll probably have a list of immediate do's and don'ts, and my neighbor will have just the opposite do's and don'ts, and life will be a big chaos. So this is one way to discover this integration which is missing, which leads to death, incapacitation. There are powers within us which disintegrate us still further. Forces, energies, movements. One such movement is desire. How does desire disintegrate? It's a root problem. It disintegrates by focusing us onto one small object to the exclusion of everything else. See what happens when people have strong desire. That's why they say there are two kinds of love that human beings experience. One is a desire-ridden love, where there is such an exclusivity on the object that everything else is lost. And it's like we cut off from the universe. It's never a healthy thing. Because when we do that, we invariably open ourselves to unconsciousness, this one kind of unconsciousness. But there is another, where there is something very healthy, where two people front the cosmos and the creation together, which is very different from two people closing themselves and cutting off from the rest of the creation. So this is one example, and it may arise for anything, one small object. There are people who chase one single thing and they forget the rest of the things. And while it may give you success, but it also is at a big expense. So there are many things. Fear. Fear also cuts us off from many things. It blinds us. So there are movements within us which cut us off from the totality, even the totality of our being. So this is one level of disintegration. There is another level of disintegration, and that is with the rest of creation. Again and again we believe somehow it's impinged upon us that, well, I am alone in this cosmos, and everything is meant to serve me. There are even some nice books. Of course, The Secret is a very good book, but it also misses a point, as if the whole cosmos is conspiring only to fulfill every person's wish. It's amazing. I mean, no, if it can happen, it'll be wonderful. Or perhaps it does, but you know, even creation and cosmos or whoever the manager is has a wonderful sense of humor. It happens in life that sometimes you wish something and it's fulfilled. But at a point of time when you don't want it or you are incapable of taking it. It's like, you know, having rasgulla when you have diabetes. An example very dear to me because of my own predicament. So, you know, it's a sad story that, you know, when you wanted rasgulla, you didn't have it. And when you get rasgulla, you have to eat karelas. It's strange. It's wish fulfillment, if you like. But at a point of time, it's so important, just one thing, to know what to wish. Nobody teaches us. Nobody teaches us the simple thing, what to wish. How to wish is later on. So there is a kind of disintegration with the world around. We don't know the rhythms of nature, rhythms of time. It's one very simple thing. You see, astrology catches a glimpse of it. that there are rhythms of time, spaces of time, loops of time in which we enter, during which we will be in the grind mill. You may like it or not. You know, I give this example. Somebody says, you know, I went to so many doctors, finally this doctor cured me. I said, you know what, your time had come. That's it. Very simple. And it's so true. And it happens. People have come to me also. I have gone to so many doctors, you know, sir, kya dawai diya? You did. I said, please don't blame me or praise me for that. It's just that you had to go through things and you went through all kinds of things. And then eventually there is a moment, because these are loops of destiny. Now during that period, we are to practice something. If we don't practice, these loops will come back again. And we have not yet, you know, it's like this world is a shadow world in which we are on a training ground for something else. The real is yet to come. It's a very beautiful line in Savitri where Shubhendu says that what we experience right now, this is not the real reality. But there is a greater power which must build reality. So this is a training ground. It means two things. One, don't take yourself too seriously. This big illusion. You know, if you are learning wrestling in a wrestling pit, don't take it too seriously that, oh, I lost. You lose today, you win tomorrow. This is not the real match. The real match is yet to begin. If we get caught into that, then life will be miserable. So this disconnection which takes place with everything, with the rhythms of time, this is very amazing that, you know, animals have this rhythm. Very spontaneously they have this. You know, they are not told that go to bed, wake up. It just doesn't happen. They know it. But we human beings have disturbed all the rhythms, and more are being disturbed. Again, basically because of the mind. Mind cuts things into fragments. Then our exclusive focus upon ourselves because of the ego. Then desire and fears add on to that. So ultimately we have cut off from the rhythms of time. In astrology, there is something which is called as Kalsarp. You know, Kalsarp means that you are going through a point of time that you may die. So one astrologer told me something very interesting. He said, you know what, people, I'm not much knowledgeable about astrology, but little bit the essence of it. So he said something very interesting. He said, you know what it really means? It means that this is a point where you are given the greatest possibility of evolution. I said, are you saying this on the basis of Sri Aurobindo or on astrology? He said, pure astrology. Then of course, all the Sanskrit texts which I didn't understand. I said, anyways, your essence is right. I quite agree with you. So there are loops of time in which we enter, which are meant to train us, to re-educate us, to reorient. There are moments that everything is snatched away from us. And this is a moment when we can rebuild our life on a new basis. It's something so wonderful. So when we have disease, it's such a lovely thing that we can be in a hospital if we have a nice room and we can sit there quietly and spend time in wondering what my life has been so far. What kind of fool I have been playing with myself and everything. Let me try to reorient. Let me take a relook. But what do we do? Doc sir, please help me. Can I survive? We lose that moment. It will get, you know, we'll get well either which way. Either we'll get well in the same body or we will get well in the other body. One of the two options are there. Eventually we will have the cure. Either a radical cure where we have a new body, or it'll be a less than radical cure where we'll have the old maladies in the same body but abated. But we have lost the opportunity. So these are moments given to us. Disease, things when life, everything seems to go wrong. These are wonderful opportunities. When all our old moorings have been cut away from us. All our strength has fallen back. We took life for granted. Ah, me, nothing can happen. Oh, look at that fellow, he has fallen sick. But when we are hit, it's first time that man discovers his vulnerability and his frailty. And when we discover our vulnerabilities, we can discover our indomitable strength. Somebody who doesn't know that he is vulnerable actually doesn't even know how strong he is or can be. Moment of adversity brings out the best in human beings, provided we take that opportunity. Otherwise, we go down the spiral of despair, gloom, this doctor, that doctor, some pathy, some medicine, some magic pill, elusive potion, till we finally discover that this is it, what it's come to teach us, to reintegrate, to reorient. But there is another problem, and that problem is real hard, as they say, practical concrete, which Sri Aurobindo and the mother take us. And it's beautifully described in Savitri. So let me read that. This is from the queen. She voices the real problem. See why we are not able to find these solutions. Sometimes the solution is very simple, but we don't state the problem rightly. The beauty of Sri Aurobindo and the mother is, they have stated the problem so beautifully and correctly. And therefore, the solution that they give is authentic, it all encompassing. So what is the problem? 1,000 ills assail the mortals ours. We know it. This is page 438. And wear away the natural joy of life. Our bodies are an engine cunningly made. Page 438. Look, this is the problem. You know, like nature has made it ingeniously. There is a side of the body which works marvelously, perfectly. But within the body, nature has left some loose ends deliberately. You may try whatever you may. Lead the most healthy lifestyle. And after a while, the skin will develop wrinkles. So you rush to a dermatologist. Oh, can't I look young? So dermatologist will give you Evian cream because he has to also look young. So he has to look young at your expense. See, I have got vitamin E. This cream, you know, my wrinkles are disappearing. Everybody can see except you. Because your mirror doesn't show. So, you know, how long can you conceal? So, we see the mirror only for 2 minutes. And the world sees us the rest of the time. So, you know. So then after a while you realize, no, this dermatologist didn't work. So you go to another, Then you discover, no, there is something like Reiki. You can look young. So go and try that. Then you discover, no, there is another thing. By this kind of will, this kind of tapasya, you can become young. So you try it. But nature is smart fellow. She has made it so cunningly. You know, scientists wonder why after a point of time nature starts introducing errors. One cause, you know, the death bomb is inside our body ticking, as it were. And it is a very fantastic name called telomerase. Something to do with murase. You know, it's there. Or erase, undoes. These words are so nice. So, it has used something inside the very genes it has introduced. You can't reach out there so easily. So it has been made so cunningly. Otherwise, imagine, you know, if one species outlasts, because nature has learned from dinosaurs' experience. Man can outdo the dinosaurs in ferocity and danger and cunning. Poor fellows are still decent. At least they eat when they are hungry, despite the, you know, that movie Jurassic Park. There is man's image of dinosaur, I'm sure. They were more decent creatures. Man can do it. Seeing something and like a cannibal, you know, in other ways. So, it is made very cunningly. But for all its parts, as cunningly are planned, contrived ingeniously with demon skill, its apt inevitable heritage of mortal danger and peculiar pain. Can't help it. It's there. The body is built in such a way. And we have to grapple with this fact that this equipment that we are using is like the old time coal engine. It runs with a certain fuel, gives lot of smoke. This is the fact. Mother speaks about it in detail in the agenda. We swallow poison with the breath. full of, as I said, not poison, I am talking of carbon dioxide emission. Nowadays they say carbon dioxide is not so much of a poison as oxygen. Telling you a fact, recently a doctor was telling me oxygen is poison. Why? Because it takes away your drive. Carbon dioxide keeps your drive. So there is a treatment, they use carbon dioxide instead of oxygen. This is the latest going on. Human mind must move in circles till it must discover there is neither oxygen nor carbon dioxide but something else. But anyways, so it's, you know, mortal danger and peculiar pain. There are, you know, the very fact that we have to draw energy from food. Simple thing. What is food? How does food get energy or capacity of energy? It's something which draws from nourishment from matter, whether it's vegetarian, non-vegetarian. In non-vegetarian, that is something added. Rage, fear, experiences of a living tissue, of a, you know, the kind of vital which animal embodies. So it's definitely, it adds to matter that fear and rage which an animal life experiences. But even vegetarian food eventually draws nourishment from below. So, you know, it's all that. And what is this matter? It is dull, inert. And that's why after a good meal, try having the same class, best sleeping pill. So after afternoon session, very good, Falguni has kept all experiential sessions. Or we should have question answer, then everybody will be awake. At least after a meal, there is a natural tendency to sleep. It has many ramifications. Why? Because we draw inertia from the food. Now, how are we to solve this problem? Man lives by food. If you go off food, few days, few weeks, but flesh cannot be recharged. Even water. Water can give energy, but it can't give substance to the flesh. So these are many issues. I am just touching them very briefly and an overview. It's payment of the tax of time and fate. Take a mortal body and there are taxpayers. Income tax every year, annual health plan. So like that, there are fellows. Where is my tax? Tax of night. So if you say, no, I don't need to pay tax. Oh, you don't need to pay tax? Okay. So the income tax officer of time is called disease. So it knocks at the door and we don't acknowledge it, enters in ties and says, come on, tell me all about your life. Give me my tax. It's way to suffer and it's way to die. This is the ransom of our high estate, the sign and stamp of our humanity. A grisly company of maladies come licensed lodgers into man's bodily house. Imagine Shurbindo's humor in Savitri. How he is using the word, he is not saying come into man's bodily house. He is saying come licensed lodgers. Grisly company of maladies. It's like imagine an illness called diabetes or hypertension come saying, may I come in? So you say, who are you? I am hypertension. Well, you can't be allowed inside, sir. You have given me the license. When did I give you the license? See, your lifestyle. You gave me the license. You can't tell me, go away. Is it? By the time you discuss, he has come and sat on the sofa and says, I am very comfortable here. Look at Shubhendu's subtle humor. Come, licensed lodgers. They have the license to enter. You may have the best of lifestyles, and yet they will enter. Purveyors of death and torturers of life. Purveyors of death. These fellows are agents. They come and say, look, you know, we just come to tell you, you are 50. Okay, remember it. No, I am 16 inside. Okay, fine. Behave like 16. After 60, do you still believe you are 16? Maybe, you know, I'm not sure. Sees the doctor bill. This is how it goes on. One by one, these agents, they come. Purveyors of death. In the malignant hollows of the world, in its subconscient cavern passages, ambushed, they lie waiting their hour to leap. This is the problem. The subconscient, where matter has grown through all kinds of challenges, imprints. That's why we are saying Deepshikadi has given the solution before the problem. Such a wonderful solution. Shima Sharanam Mama. Why? Because imagines, they are lying in the subconscious passages. What is lying in the subconscious passages? Whole experience of the animal creation. What is the experience of the animal creation? Death, suffering, all those things. Whole our human past with all the diseases lying inside us like a miasm, what homeopaths call as miasm. It is there inside, waiting for its hour. We don't even know. We have slept very well. Ah, so nice. Only if life can be so wonderful. And then morning, we get up with, I'm not feeling too well. I have got a fever. And then you go to a doctor. Doctor, is it swine flu by any chance? You know, our human mind is strange. It doesn't think of anything less. It has to be maximum, as if it's also a prestige issue. As if an ordinary common cold is not worth having. I must have swine flu. Something sounds impressive, no? Not some ordinary malady like common cold. Common cold is for common people. So swine flu. And doctor has to break his head telling you, please, it's don't start thinking of such, you know, dangerous thing. But they are there. Where did they come from? They are there in the atmosphere. They have entered into our subconscious passages from the TV, from everywhere. Everybody, you know, you get down on an airport. Now it's not there, but when swine flu was going on, I still remember morning time, you are half sleepy, half groggy, and you are going, suddenly there is a doctor waiting there with a thermometer and you don't know what's gone wrong. And he's checking everybody's temperature. What is this? Now, God forbid, if you had a fever that day, you were gone. Later on, you will discover. But you know, you won't, can't tell him, I have called the taxi from Pondicherry, he'll charge me any which way. Because just that kind of fear is all around. Mother speaks of it in Japan, that everybody is wearing a mask because of fear. So subconscious is so full of these things, even when we don't know. When, you know, we think everything is fine. That's why nowadays a new kind of disease has cropped up, and somebody has talked about it in a very good article. And this, that disease is called news. So you watch the news and you are sick. You know, you don't have to go very far. Just 5 minutes of tune into a channel and you'll be sick. If not that day, then by evening. Unless you have a wonderful sense of humor. Then you can say, what these fellows, these are the fellows we have selected. My God. These are the fellows who govern the country. Every time it's, you know, or you just look at life with those calm eyes and wideness. And yet, to all this complicated stuff, there is a very simple solution. But so difficult that human beings can't put their will towards that. And that solution is, at the end of it, Savitri gives in so many ways. One is, but after describing all the maladies in man and what it can do and what it can cannot do, at the end there are two lines, very beautiful line. But there is a guardian power. There are hands that save. Calm eyes divine regard the human scene. Poor doctors will become unemployed if they give this thing. And they will think this fellow doesn't know. So you have to conceal this great truth through a great number of complicated things. Because we have faith in everything except the calm eyes divine. So imagine a clinic, new age clinic, where you come and it's full of divine presence. You don't even know who is the doctor and where is the doctor. And you come out of it, this is my conception of a, you know, millennium, when we don't have to see a doctor and we come out of a healing space. And we come out, we just live there and we come out and feel, ah, I don't need to see a doctor. When Niruddha asked the mother, and with this maybe we can stop if there are some questions. Niruddha asked the mother that, Aurobindo, I believe mother is going to build a big hospital in Pondicherry. Dreams of a millennium, what? It was his way of asking Shivan. Dreams of a millennium, what? That, you know, big hospital. He's very happy. He's a doctor after all. So, if mother builds a big hospital, it's so wonderful. You know, after all, spiritual organizations must do something, no? Samaj Seva, social work. So, hospitals are social work. Shobindo's one line reply, it will be more of a dream of the millennium if there are no more doctors and no more injections. That would be a dream accomplished.